Penguin Random House Audio presents The Wicked Sister by Karen Dionne. Read for you by Kristen Sieh and Andi Arndt. Truth is like the sun. You can shut it out for a time, but it ain't going away. Elvis Presley. Author's note. Readers familiar with Michigan's Upper Peninsula will note that I've made a small adjustment to history for the sake of this story. While this novel takes place in the present day and Rachel's narrative unfolds as if the Newberry Regional Mental Health Center is currently in operation, the health center shuttered its doors in 1992, and the renovated buildings now house a medium security prison. 1. Now, Rachel. Sometimes when I close my eyes, there is a rifle in my hands. My hands are small. My fingers are pudgy. I'm 11 years old. There's nothing special about this particular rifle, nothing to distinguish it from any other Remington, except that this is the rifle that killed my mother. In my vision, I am standing over my mother. The rifle is pointing at her chest. Her mouth is open, and her eyes are closed. Her chest is red. My father runs into the front hallway. "Rachel!" he screams when he sees me. He drops to his knees, gathers my mother in his arms, looks up at me, his expression an unfamiliar jumble of shock and horror. He rocks my mother for a long time as if she is a baby, as if she is alive. At last he lays her gently on the worn parquet floor and gets slowly to his feet. He takes the rifle from my trembling hands and looks at me with a sorrow greater than I can comprehend, and turns the rifle on himself. "Not so," says the golden orb spider from the middle of her web in a corner of my room where the cleaners never sweep. "Your father killed your mother, and then he killed himself." I don't understand why the spider is lying. Spiders normally tell the truth. "How do you know?" I can't resist asking. She wasn't there when my parents died. I was. The spider regards me solemnly from 8 shiny eyes.
"I know," she says. "We all know."
Her spiderlings skitter about the edges of the web, as insubstantial as dust motes, and nod. I want to tell the spider that she is wrong, that I know better than anyone what happened the day my parents died, and I understand the consequences of my childhood crime better than she ever will, because I've been living with them for 15 years. Once you've taken someone's life, it breaks you, shatters you into so many infinitesimal pieces that no one and nothing can put you together again. Ask any drunk driver who killed a pedestrian, any hunter who thought the friend or brother-in-law he shot was a deer, anyone who held a loaded rifle when she was too young to anticipate what was about to happen. My therapists say I'm suffering from complicated grief disorder and promise I'll get better in time. My therapists are wrong. I'm getting worse. I can't sleep, and when I do, I have nightmares. I get frequent headaches, and my stomach hurts all the time. I used to think constantly about killing myself, until I realized that living in a mental hospital for the rest of my life is the greater punishment. I eat, I sleep, I read, I watch TV, I go outside, I breathe the warm summer air, feel the sun on my skin, listen to the birds chirp and the insects hum, watch the flowers bloom and the leaves turn and the snow fall. And through it all, always, always in the front of my mind and deep in my heart, burns this terrible truth. I am the reason my parents will never see, smell, taste, laugh, or love again. My parents are dead because of me. The police ruled my parents' deaths a murder-suicide, perpetrated by my father. All the news reports I've been able to find agree. Peter James Cunningham, age 45, murdered his wife, Jennifer Marie Cunningham, age 43, for undetermined reasons. and then turned the rifle on himself. Some speculate that I saw my father shoot my mother, and that's why I ran away. Others that I found my parents' bodies, and this is what sent me over the edge. I would have told them that I was responsible if I had been able to speak. When I came out of my catatonia 3 weeks later, I made sure that everyone who would listen knew what I had done. But to this day, no one believes me. Not even the spider. 2. I leave the spider to her offspring and check my watch, a cheap plastic model my Aunt Charlotte bought at the dollar store after the last one she gave me was stolen, and head down 2 flights to the community room. One of the cable channels is showing the original Star Trek movie this afternoon, and I promised my friend Scotty I'd make sure that nobody changes the channel. My footsteps echo in the empty stairwell. I'm wearing tennis shoes. Velcro fasteners, the only kind we're allowed. The ceramic floor tiles are cracked or missing. The plaster on the walls and ceiling flaked and peeling. My room is in one of the oldest buildings, which dates from the hospital's opening in 1895, back when it was called the Upper Peninsula Asylum for the Insane. Newberry Regional Mental Health Center, as it's known today, is definitely better. But it still is what it is. One of 2 major adult psychiatric hospitals in the state of Michigan, this one in the Upper Peninsula, and the other in the lower, where the mentally ill go to get better and the terminally insane live out their days. I fall somewhere in between. I exit the stairwell into a wall of sound. The corridor is crowded. Patients, nurses, patients with nurses in lockstep beside them, because after a meal, bulimics can't be left alone. Orderlies, housekeepers, a doctor in a white coat. I hug the wall, keep my head down. I don't speak to anyone. No one speaks to me. My therapists are always saying that I should get to know my roommates and the others in my therapy group, but it's hard to see the point of making friends with someone who's only going to leave. I navigate the glass-enclosed passageway between the dormitory and the administration building that gets as hot as Hades on a sunny day. Unbreakable plexiglass. The staff makes sure new arrivals know, and open the door to the community room. The community room is as dreary as you'd expect for a mental institution that's over 100 years old. Dirt-stained, cream-colored walls, worn green asbestos floor tile, heavy metal-framed, multi-paned windows so no one can jump out, vinyl chairs and couches patched with duct tape and bolted to the floor. It's also noisy. The television turned up far too loud so it can be heard over the conversations of visitors and patients who are talking much too loudly so they can be heard over the noise of the television. And it smells. A combination of stale cooking odors and disinfectant that my Aunt Charlotte says reminds her of a nursing home overlaid with the stink of cigarettes. Practically everyone at the hospital smokes. Cigarettes are free. A clever ploy by the tobacco companies to get us addicted and make us customers for life. Or merely another calming drug in the hospital's abundant arsenal, I couldn't say. Its lighters and matches were not allowed, along with shoelaces, drawstrings, plastic grocery store bags, trash can liners, and dozens of other ordinary yet potentially lethal items that people who don't live in mental institutions get to use every day. Even at that, there have been 2 successful suicides since I've been here. One girl unraveled a sweater and braided the yarn back together to make a rope, then tied the rope around her neck and threw the other end over a pipe near the bathroom ceiling and climbed up on the toilet and stepped off. Another drank a bottle of drain cleaner she stole from a cleaning cart when no one was looking. The cleaning woman lost her job over that. Still, when you consider that at least half the patients, and probably more, are here because they've either attempted suicide or have threatened to, you have to give the staff credit.
Ursa!
Scotty calls from across the room when he sees me. He jumps up and flaps his hands. I smile and wave back. Scotty is a child in a man's body. Big and broad-shouldered, with arms that look like they could crush you with a hug, but who's soft as a marshmallow inside, with watery blue eyes and dishwater blonde hair, and a mental age of somewhere around 9. Scotty is not his real name, by the way. I only call him that because of his obsession with Star Trek. the same way he calls me Ursula because of my love for bears. Scotty's brother, Trevor, is also waiting on the sofa. My stomach does its usual flip-flop when I see him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.